A very good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. There are no apologies this morning, and our first item of business today is to agree to take items 3 and 4 on today's agenda in private. Are we all agreed? Okay, thank you. So our next agenda item is consideration of evidence on the Children's Care and Justice Bill. And I welcome to the meeting this morning Mrs. Linda Allen and Kate Wallace, Chief Executive Officer of Victim Support Scotland. So welcome to you both. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2. So I thank both our witnesses for coming along today and sharing your views on the Scottish Government's proposals. So I intend to allow about an hour for this session, and I'm aware that Kate Wallace, you will need to leave us by no later than 10:45, as I understand that you're also giving evidence to the Education Committee this morning, so you've got a busy morning ahead. So we'll now move directly to questions. And I wonder if I can just open things up and maybe come to you first, Kate. I wonder if you could just provide the committee with a broad overview of the work that you are involved in relation to children and young people.
Thank you. Yes, so we at Victim Support Scotland support victims of any type of crime, and that will be victims who are victims of crime committed by adult perpetrators or children and young people. So we provide support to anyone who needs it, both in the community setting but also within the court setting. So we've had some feedback from some of the people that we support around the bill and around some of the key concerns that they have. One of the things that we had, in particular, that we've raised at the consultation stage as well, and that unfortunately hasn't been picked up in the bill just as in the way that we had anticipated, and I know that others have given evidence to the Education Committee about this, is to do with the provision of information that I thought this committee would be interested in. So the reality is that people who have been harmed by children or young people are not entitled to the same information as if that was an adult who had harmed them. There is no victim notification scheme in place. Children may be placed in secure care, as is obviously proposed to do more of through this bill. But for example, there's no victim notification scheme, so victims who could, you know, for example, could be have been subjected to a serious sexual assault are not told when someone is being released from secure accommodation, therefore meaning that they can't effectively plan for their own safety. So I realise that wasn't a specific question that this committee wanted to ask, but I did want to raise it because I thought from your perspective it's something that you would be interested in. The reality is that people who have been harmed by children or young people are not entitled to any information. They're entitled to ask, but they don't get any information about what's happened to the child who has offended against them.
And I wonder just, I know that members will be interested in that specific issue that you've raised about victim notification and the differences in relation to situations where you've got a child perpetrator versus an adult. I wonder if I can just pick up on the broad work that you do and whether or not over time you've seen changes in perhaps the numbers that you are supporting, the profile of children that you're supporting, just as a general overview of how things are developing.
So I haven't looked at the figures in detail, but it is a component of the work that we do for sure. And we support, for example, people where the adult process might have been pursued first and then there's a decision taken that it will go through the children's hearing system. So we have supported children and young people through that and adults who have been harmed by children and young people as well, as I know other organisations have too. So I think, you know, we, in terms of a profile. I haven't seen necessarily any changes to that except in terms of numbers that I can share with the committee, but the types of crimes, particularly around sexual crime, violent crime, those kind of things, you know, and I've spoken to this committee, I think, before in the past around the kind of the relationship between the adult system and then the child system and what the issues that then places victims and, you know, and the challenges that they have around that. So, for example, bail conditions that might be put in place in the adult system that then a decision is taken to take the child through a children's hearing system, those bail conditions are dropped because they're obviously not relevant in a hearing system, but there's no other alternatives at the moment in terms of protecting safety. So there's, you know, and we are involved in and have been supporting, and the and committee members will be aware of some pretty difficult cases of people who have, you know, at the higher end have been harmed by children and young people, and some of the challenges of those complex cases where, for example, you may have children who've been harmed by another child or other children, and they're in the same school environment, for example, and I know that's been discussed in the Education Committee last week too. So there's nothing that I'm seeing in terms of trends, but I haven't particularly looked for that, I have to say. So I could do more digging around that and send any further information to the committee if that would be helpful.
Thank you, Kate. So I'll come to you now, Linda. I mean, the committee is very aware of the traumatic experience that you have had of the criminal justice system. So I wonder if you'd just be able to sort of articulate that experience to members and how it's brought you round to the work that you're undertaking now.
Thank you. We've not experienced traumatic. We're experiencing. It's not finished. So our daughter Katie committed driving offences in 2017 and was a first-time offender and was sentenced to a custodial sentence in Pullmont Young Offenders Institute, where she took her own life. And obviously, I'm a researcher. I'm in part of coming to terms with and trying to understand what had happened to her daughter in the establishment. I started doing some digging and collecting data along with my husband, who's helpfully a data analyst. So together we started collecting data on deaths in prison custody in Scotland. So we now have quite a comprehensive database going back to 2005, which led on to us looking at fatal accident inquiry outcomes and the role they play in death investigation. And with colleagues at Glasgow University, we've published some findings from that work. Our own personal experience is we still wait on a fatal accident inquiry for our daughter's death, and it will be 5 years on the 4th of June since our daughter died. The main reason for that is we're pursuing criminal conviction, and it's taken the Crown Office this length of time to investigate, and they are still doing so.
Thank you very much. I'm just going to open it straight up to members now and I'll bring in Rona Mackay, followed by Jamie.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. So the provisions in the bill ensures that no child under the age of 18 can be held in a young offenders institution or prison, either on remand or while awaiting sentence or having been sentenced. Can I ask you, I'll start with you, Linda, can I ask you your view on that? And then I'll ask Kate.
I don't think it'll be a surprise to the committee that I don't think it goes far enough. It's quite confusing in terms of the new sentencing guidelines that were published in 2022 and the robust research into neurodevelopment, and they apply to under the age of 25. Why a bill would be introduced that didn't reflect that robust research. I can only speak from our experience, you know, and prisons are not therapeutic environments. And, you know, Katie was probably a bit different from many young people that end up in custodial sentences, in custodial settings. It makes no sense to me why we as a society put traumatised, disenfranchised young people into a traumatic environment to be strip searched despite the previous Justice Secretary saying no under 18 should be strip searched in 2019, still being strip searched, still being isolated, particularly in remand. I had a quick look at our database before coming to the committee, and there's been two young people under the age of 18 that have died since 2005, Regan and William. But if you look at under 25, that increases to 49 people, 70% of which have taken their own life within the first 3 months. I mean, we're pursuing what we're pursuing because that's what we want to change. Young people should not be dying in prison.
So assuming that you see this as a step forward because it's, you know, referring to children under the age of 18, but you would like the age to be more in line with the Sentencing Council guidelines. You see that as an anomaly. Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Kate, what's your view on it?
Well, our concern that's been raised by victims with us is about the making sure that the issues that there are within young offenders' risk institutions aren't replicated in secure accommodation. So, you know, really getting an understanding about the reasons and what has happened in there, and making sure that young people who are in secure accommodation, who are there either because of welfare concerns, have been victims of crime themselves and there's serious concerns about their safety and there's been a decision to place them in a secure environment, making sure that those vulnerable children and young people are not placed at risk because at the moment the proposal in the bill is, regardless of the seriousness of the offence, that all children up until the age of 19 would be placed within secure accommodation. So our key concerns around that are around robust risk assessment, around making sure that does not have a detrimental impact on and increase the risk for other children and young people who are in secure accommodation, who will, you know, as we've just heard, perhaps have, be there for welfare reasons, have welfare concerns, or have, be fairly low-level offending.
So, if I'm understanding correctly, are you saying that children under the age of 18 who've committed a serious crime, such as murder or rape or whatever, should be held in young offenders institutions or prison?
I think our response to that would be that we can see that there would be merit in not having them in young offenders institutions, but only if they're in secure care, and secure is going to be different from that, so making sure we don't replicate that, so potentially looking at how you can create something for children who've committed very serious offences so that they are perhaps not in as much contact with other young people who are more vulnerable or who haven't committed those types of serious offences.
Yeah.
That's our concern. We wouldn't... So we're not against it per se, but it's about making sure that the same issues aren't replicated within just a different institution.
OK, thank you. Thanks, Convener. Thank you.
OK, thanks. I'll bring in Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for coming in and thank you for sharing your experience. I know it's been a horrific couple of years for you and your family, and it's very brave of you to come and share that with us in committee. It's very important as well. And I'm sorry to hear this is an ongoing process. What I'm trying to get my head around, though, just as it's important we take as wide a range of views on it, of evidence as we can on the legislation and the government's proposal. The government obviously has, you know, there are three places that that someone can be sent, either on remand or having been sentenced and held in custody, and that's obviously secure accommodation, young offenders institutions, or adult prisons. And what I'm trying to get my head around is where people think is the right place for certain cohorts of people. Now, at the moment, it seems to be based on an arbitrary age cut-off. So the bill will propose that up to 19 years of age, effectively, so in your 18th year, you can only be held in secure accommodation with an expectation you would probably then move to a young offenders institution. Depending on the length of your sentence, it would be unusual to be so long, but in the unlikely event it was longer than that, you would then be moved to an adult prison at some point, perhaps over 25 plus. Is that a setup that you are comfortable with? Do you think that works? Do you think that age is the factor that should be taken into account? Do you think there are other factors which should be taken into account? How should the government best create rules to know that these settings are the right settings for the people that are put into them? Because that's where I'm a bit confused by perhaps some of the evidence that I've heard so far. I'll start with Kate, then I'll come on to you, Ms Allen.
So I think, as I kind of mentioned it just before, from our perspective, risk and seriousness of offence would be the two main criteria, really. And also the provisions that are in place to, you know, monitor, supervise, support, you know, the therapeutic interventions that have been discussed. So it's, you know, about, and I've said this to this committee before, for victims, mostly what they want is to make sure that what happens to them doesn't happen to anybody else. So it's about the most effective approach to that. And they are concerned about their own safety, about being able to plan for their own safety as well. And they are concerned about justice. But that tends to come, in my experience, after making sure that what's happened to them doesn't happen to anybody else. So we would see the kind of main criteria being around seriousness of offence and around risk and risk management and risk assessment, and then the most appropriate setting from there. And there's, you know, and there may well be decisions to be made about timescales to do with that, because you may well have, you know, independent, and we can think of some fairly high-profile cases where, you know, children may only have 6 months where they might be moved out of a young offenders institution into secure accommodation, then back into a young offenders institution, and then, as you say, you know, moved into adult prison for those very small number of children and young people who've committed very, very, very serious offences. And I think there's a decision to be made about whether that level of disruption, particularly and potentially risk around other children, young people, as I mentioned earlier on, is the right approach. But more generally, yeah, we would be saying risk assessment and seriousness of offence.
I guess what I'm trying to work out is what is the role of a Young Offenders Institute, because there seems to be opposition at both ends, people who think that there are people who are old enough to be in adult prisons that may be in YOIs, but there are people on the lower end of the age spectrum who absolutely shouldn't be in them at all. It's difficult to actually see what their place is in the justice system in that scenario. To pose a scenario, you know, should a 24-year-old adult male who's committed a serious sexual assault or rape against someone be held in is it appropriate to be holding them in young offenders institutions? Or equally, an 18-year-old who's committed the same offence, who may be of sound mind, would they appropriately be held in secure accommodation? Are you saying that it would be okay as long as they're separate from children, other younger children, if you like? I guess there's a moral, philosophical question here about, you know, how we treat people, because everyone's an individual and they're, you know, where they're at in the system is very unique as well. I'm trying to get my head around how we can use arbitrary rules to deal with what are quite complex individual cases.
Yeah, and from our perspective, we think that risk assessment is key to that, as is a real understanding about the, you know, the setups of the different institutions that you've just referred to, and what's in place, and what, you know, and I know that others have given evidence to committee about other committees about resources and about what's required, and that kind of thing. So it's quite difficult to answer your question on the basis of what's in place just now. Other than, you know, for our perspective, we would be saying, as I say, robust risk assessment. And as part of that, obviously taking into account the seriousness of offences that have been perpetrated.
Okay, thank you. Did you like to comment on anything?
Yeah, thanks. I think it is a philosophical dilemma, but I also think it's a moral one. And I think what we're doing just now is not wise, you know, from a rights perspective, from an economic perspective. And my answer to your question is no child or young person should be sent to prison. They should be sent to a therapeutic environment that reduces reoffending and keeps them alive. I mean, the facts speak for themselves. Reoffending rates, number of deaths in custody of young people. All we're doing is re-traumatising young people. So what we're doing just now does not work. What we need is a model that does work. I'm not an expert in secure accommodation, so I can't comment on whether that would be the answer to this problem. But certainly Young Offenders Institutes are not the answer to the problem.
What do you think their role is? Because this is something I've grappled with over the last year as we've taken a lot of evidence on issues around this. Do they have a role in Scottish justice?
Well, I think it's a broader question. Is what's the role of prisons? You know, I mean, I think we still have a Victorian model of retribution, you know, and we stick on top of that a label of rehabilitation. And that doesn't work. And we've got one of the highest imprisonment rates in Europe. We've got the highest deaths in custody rate, and certainly in the UK, if not wider. So these are just facts. So what we're doing, you know, a Victorian model of retribution with a label of rehabilitation is not working.
And just finally, what would you like to see from the Crown Office? I know I'm not talking about any live proceedings that may be ongoing. I don't think that would be appropriate. But clearly 5 years is an awful long time to be waiting for anything to happen. You're not the only family that to be waiting that long. What improvements would you like to see in the Crown Office? What would be your big ask of the new Justice Minister?
I would
Minister?
Like to see our domestic law reflecting European law, because just now it doesn't. We have no legal redress because of Crown immunity in Scottish prisons. Or the Scottish prison estate, not the private. If Katie had died in Kilmarnock prison, we would have legal redress, but we don't because she died in Pullman. The Corporate Manslaughter Homicide Act has not been used against any state organisation, let alone the prison service. I had a very wise friend describe it this way to me. If you go into a restaurant and you get food poisoning, there might be, you know, some discussion about that. If somebody else goes in and dies of food poisoning, there might be an inquiry. But if that happens every single week, then there would be a root and branch inquiry and investigation in the police. That's what's happening in our prisons.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you,
Kavira. Thank you. I'll bring in Pauline, followed by Fulton.
Thank you very much. Good morning. I wanted to explore this kind of area of policy and whether you think that if we did explore, as Linda, you've said, that we should go further, if we're actually equipped to do it. So, like Jamie, trying to get my head around all of this. And Kate, you said earlier what your concern would be, and you focused on the need for the risk assessment for secure accommodation. But I just wondered, in policy terms, does it all fit together? In my limited understanding, so secure accommodation, well, for a start, we don't have enough of it, so that's a question we'll have to address to ministers. But the principle of the welfare of the child is the overriding principle of the children's hearing system. So regardless of any offences, looking after the welfare of the child. But if we go beyond the age of 18, I think we need to explore how that then is going to operate, because between the ages of 18 and 21, they're not children. So if we were going to put them in secure accommodation, it seems to me that it doesn't really fit together. And I'm just wondering, as you're speaking, that maybe actually, if we're serious about it, then perhaps there'd be a bit of a redesign needed then. Because when I'm reading through the briefing, so you're not going to hold under-18s in Pullman any longer, Young Offenders Institution. You might go beyond that. Now, there's reference to cases of remand, but it can either be secure accommodation or a place of safety, and I really don't know what that means. It just kind of feels that the policy doesn't really fit with the system, you need to really kind of have a whole scale change to the system. Because I have to say, my own view is, I don't know that risk assessment would be enough in a serious offence to satisfy victims or victims' families. That simply putting everyone together in secure accommodation is really a satisfactory solution to that. So if you want to respond in any way to that, I would be very grateful. Thank you.
Do you want me to go first?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think there's balance. The other challenge that you've raised is around balancing the rights of different people within the system. So one of the challenges at the moment, so linking back to the point I was making earlier on around information provision, what we've got at the moment is a system and an approach which prioritises the rights of children who've harmed over either adults or children who have been harmed, because they're not entitled to it and don't get any information about what's happened in terms of their case, if you like. So at the moment, and there is in one of the, I noticed it in the Education Committee last week, one of the sessions discussed that, so that for the rights of children and the welfare of children to be paramount, what you've actually got is, because of that lack of information, you've got the children who have harmed being prioritised over if, in this case, the victim has been a child who are not able then to participate in proceedings like the UNCRC would suggest. So there is a set of challenges, I think, around that. And as I said earlier on, the other challenges around seriousness of offence. You could take an approach which is murder, culpable homicide, certain domestic abuse offences, rape, serious sexual assault are dealt with as a group. But you're right in a way, because unless you address some of these challenges that there are, and that, you know, that is partly what I'll say in my next committee session, because there was all sorts of discussion around that in the consultation period process that didn't materialise in the bill.
Just on that point, so if you looked at serious offence, murder, culpable homicide, you're thinking then that perhaps there should be a separate element of the secure accommodation estate then, if we're going to extend the... So I'm thinking both about seriousness and about age as well, between 18 and 25, if you like, that maybe the answer lies in actually reorganising the secure accommodation estate. Would that be something that might work?
Potentially, yeah.
Thanks.
That's one of our suggestions, but I am not pretending to be an expert in secure care. But I think going back to the point about other children and young people who are there for other reasons and protecting their safety and their... their welfare. I think we do have to think about how we would manage it.
Linda?
Yeah, I mean, I think you're absolutely right. There needs to be a complete overhaul and review. You know, if we did have enough secure accommodation, William Lindsay would still be alive today. So we don't have enough for the existing population of under-18s, let alone, you know, if we extended the upper age limit. I think there is a danger of recreating a Young Offenders Institute under another name, and that's not what any of us would want. It might be helpful to the committee. I was reflecting on something Katie said to me when she was in Pullman, and she said, Mum, there are three types of women here, because there's older women in Pullman as well that were moved from Corton Vale. There are women like me who have made a mistake and are here for the first time. There are women here who find this place safer than it is at home for them. So they'll go out and reoffend, so they're back here because it's safer. And they're women who are really unwell. She didn't describe any of the women that were with her in Pullman as criminals or murderers or whatever. She described them in that way. And I think if you look at it in that way, there's a solution to all of that, you know. So is it about forensic services? Is it about, you know, what's it about? But it's certainly not the model that we have just now. One thing that might be interesting for the committee to find out is, since the introduction of the sentencing guidelines, has there been a reduction in under-25s being sent to prison?
Okay.
I think it's a very astute observation that she made, and it does beg the question, and people they'll be divided on it, but it does beg the question in sentencing terms whether or not in the first place in custody should be the first thought in cases like that. But I've no further questions, but thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Fulton and then Russell.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you both, Linda and Kate, for your evidence today. I think that was really powerful when you spoke about your daughter's description of people that she was in Pullman with, and I think, you know, it's why it's so important that we hear that sort of evidence. And I just want to, as others have done, put on record my thanks to you for coming forward. My question's a wee bit around, I was going to say it's a wee bit left field, but it does relate. So I know that Kate will be aware, because she's given evidence, and you might be aware, Linda, through your research, that this committee is actually looking at another bit of legislation just now, the bail and release bill, which we're moved into stage two on. And one of the purposes of that bill is to try and reduce the number of people who are in remand in the first place. That's its aim, essentially. And there's debate about how that or will it work. But that is its main aim, is to reduce the number of people in remand. How do you think, I'll start with yourself, Kate, how do you think that bill overlaps with the work of this bill? Because clearly here as well, we're looking at, you know, children under 18 not being placed in custodial settings. So do you think there's an overlap between the pieces of legislation, and how can the bits of legislation work together, do you think, in your view?
Again, I think it comes back to the point that I made to the committee before around bail and release bill, and the point I'm making here around seriousness of offence and about risk being posed. You know, I haven't looked at the, and I think Linda's maybe got them actually, in statistics about, you know, who is in young offenders institutions on remand, what age they are, and what is the offence that they have been accused of. But in the statistics overall, as I said to this committee before, 60% of people on remand in the government's own figures were there because they'd been accused of sexual or violent offences. And as I said before, there is an important thing to remember about remand in terms of what is the purpose. Now, we've never been in agreement about an appropriate use of remand, but we do think that for some people it is the only way of keeping victims safe for a period of time. So yeah, and how that interplays with this, I don't know enough about the figures about who's on remand and for what, being accused of what crimes, but I think the same approach would remain from our perspective. Victims would be very concerned about their safety if the alternatives to remand were not keeping them safe, in the way that we know that at the moment bail supervision doesn't. You know, I gave the figures to the committee last time, which was that 11 people had been convicted of murder whilst they were out on bail. And a whole host of, you know, nearly 200 people convicted of attempted murder and serious assault while they were out on bail. So the concern from victims would be that the alternatives that were in place would ensure their safety, and would be a proper alternative to remand. And that would be the same for children and young people as it is for adults who have, you know, from their point of view, perpetrated crimes against them.
Thanks, Kate. And in terms of yourself, you've already said, I think, in response to Ronan Mackay, that you don't think this bill goes far enough in terms of the age, and I would probably agree with that as well to an extent. But I'm conscious, though, of the seriousness of offences. I think that's an important part in it. So how do you think that the legislation, either here or other legislation, either the one referred to or legislation that doesn't currently exist, how do you think the Scottish Government can make things better in terms of the appropriateness of remand? I think, to use Kate's expression there, you know, when making sure that we're using remand at the right time and we're not perhaps coming across situations where people are in remand, the situation might be more difficult for them and the perception have been there.
I think the difficulty is it's, you know, it's the court, it's the, you know, that will make these decisions. It will be the sheriff or the judge that will decide whether a young person is to be remanded or not. I don't know enough about the bail and release bill to add much, but I do know that children and young people on remand are more likely to take their own lives. And I do know that over 60% of the under-21s in Pullman as of February this year are on remand, which is quite staggering. And I know that inspection report after inspection report have highlighted the difficulties with the opportunities that young people have whilst on remand in young offenders institutes, access to education, access to, you know, time out of cell, 23 hours in a cell. You know, COVID restrictions are not all away in our prison estate. You know, many of our prisoners are still spending inordinate amounts of time within their cells.
Thanks, Linda.
Very much for bringing Russell.
Thanks very much. Hi, Linda. Thank you for coming in. I can't imagine what you've been put through these past 5 years. Now, in that time, we know that more than 200 people have died in Scottish prisons. Many of them will be young people by suicide also. And you're still waiting for your fatal accident inquiry to begin. This has partly been due to the attempts to criminally prosecute people, which in October last year was rejected, I understand. Do you know if that rejection was based on the Crown not being able to, or is it entirely at their discretion?
In terms of a prosecution under the Health and Safety Act, it's because they're unable to, because of Crown immunity. So the Crown Office, I don't want to say too much because obviously it's an ongoing case, but certainly the Crown are unable to prosecute under the Health and Safety Act despite what they believe is credible and reliable evidence. For a successful prosecution, they cannot prosecute under health and safety legislation because the Scottish Prison Service has Crown immunity.
So what happened in October wasn't the final word. There's still, that process is still ongoing.
We're challenging that, yep. Right. And we're also challenging the Crown's decision not to prosecute under corporate homicide manslaughter.
Although,
can I just remind members, just to make sure that our lines of questioning are not about a specific case and instead about the bill. Thank you.
Sure. The reason I wanted to establish where we are just now in the background, because we're talking about legislation, and I wondered if there's anything that you could see this bill doing that would help address these issues of immunity from prosecution, for example.
Well, yes, if we don't send young people to Young Offenders Institute, they won't die. So it's as simple as that. Therefore, families like us, like the Lindsay family and the Marshall family and many other people won't be in the position that we're in.
In terms of immunity from prosecution, could the bill do anything about that if there were tragic cases?
I believe Crown immunity is reserved. I'd be delighted if it could, obviously, but I believe it's a reserved issue.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Now, Kate, you spoke earlier about the prioritisation of the rights of those who've harmed other children over the rights of those who've been harmed. The Daily Record newspaper is running a campaign just now, Our Kids, Our Future, which just talks about a large number of such cases, many of which are recorded on social media and adding to the distress of those who've been attacked. Now, one such case involves a 12-year-old who was beaten quite severely. It was filmed. It's had profound effect on this individual's entire life, understandably. In the past few weeks, there's been developments in that case in that they believed that the alleged perpetrator was subject to bail conditions, only to discover that they were no longer, and this hadn't been communicated to them. This alleged perpetrator has also allegedly committed further offences. And I know that this is a specific case, but what I'd like to ask is what measures could the bill take to give greater protection to victims?
So from our perspective, information sharing and addressing those issues and those deficiencies that I've described, some of that was discussed in the consultation preceding the bill. I think this is the place to do it, and I think those information sharing provisions and being clear about what information can and will be shared with people who have been harmed by a child or young person. I think that just really needs to be spelled out, and the types of information that will be shared, and because what you've got is someone who, if you go through an adult system, you have rights to information about updates to do with your case. You've got rights to information about, for example, if somebody, if someone escapes from or absconds from a prison setting, you're entitled to that information. If you sign up to the victim notification scheme, you're also entitled to know when that person has been released. None of those provisions translate when it's a child or young person who has harmed you. So I think that the bill needs to, that whole part of it needs to be looked at, and provisions need to be put in place really around that. And I know that in the Education Committee last week, someone raised the point about if the person who's been harmed is a child as well, the imbalance in terms of rights and how the UNCRC for the child who's been harmed is not, they're not able to fully participate in proceedings in the way that the convention sets out. So I think there's quite a big bit of work to be done on that within this bill.
Do you think also the children's hearing system is understandably essentially private in the main? Do you think there should be any scope to have more transparency around these proceedings generally?
I think that's what we need in the bill, to allow that to happen within the hearing system, because that's where many children will be will go through. But I think that's absolutely right, because at the moment people can make a request from SCRA, but SCRA won't provide the information.
Is it the case that more cases of violence, for example, committed by children against children, are ending up going down that legal route, the children's panel? I know that the Crown still have the option to prosecute, but because this is the direction of travel, if there was more transparency around hearings generally, that would be a good thing.
Definitely. It's one of the biggest issues that comes to us for people in this situation, is they're really quite struck and surprised by the lack of information, and there's a lot of effort put into explaining the process to them, but they don't get any information about their own particular set of circumstances, and therefore it was very difficult for people to understand around what's happening to the perpetrator, if you like, but it's also really difficult for them to safety plan, for their own recovery as well. That all becomes really challenging when you're operating in a total information vacuum, and you certainly don't want people relying on social media, because in terms of factual accuracy, I would suggest that that's not the place where you're going to get that factually accurate information.
So for all the frustrations with the criminal justice system for adults, which we've heard much about, there's a complete vacuum in respect of children's hearings. So if someone's a victim of a crime, they don't get told about what's happening up until the point of disposal, what the disposal is, or any details whatsoever. There's no entitlement whatsoever.
Because if you remember, though, the children's hearing system is not, you've just used the phrase disposal, that's not how the hearing system works. It's not about that. People don't get information about their own situation specifically at all. They get information about the process, is our experience, but not information about their own particular case.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to have to jump right in. I'm just watching the time for you leaving, Kate Wallace, so can I just let you go? Thank you very much for coming in. We'll just have a quick pause to let you leave the committee room. Thank you.
Rowan's got a question for Linda.
Okay. Oh. Okay, thank you very much, members. So we'll just continue with our questions, and I'm going to bring in Rona. I think you've got a question for
Linda. Thanks, Convener. Linda, it was just when you were speaking earlier about 60% of children on remand, young and do you have any stats to say roughly how long they spend on average in remand?
But I'm sure Wendy will be able to answer that question in the next panel.
Yeah, was prolonged or just an average work, but thank you.
It's certainly increased during the pandemic for obvious reasons, and it is a big risk factor in suicide.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring in Colette Stevenson now.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Linda, and thanks for coming along and sharing your story. And, you know, despite the trauma that you're still experiencing, the research that you've done is absolutely amazing, and it's absolutely heartening to hear that might have an impact going forward for our young people who are affected by the justice system. So thank you so much for that. One of the things I wanted to... You touched upon this about therapeutic pathways for our young people who are going through the justice system. So and I don't know if you got the opportunity, but there was evidence from St Mary's, the secure accommodation, about therapeutic milieu of secure care and how what can that look like, and how would you see how we can check on that to see how is that working for the young people, and should it be regulated as well? In order to see how they're getting on, how they're progressing, especially if it is more of a serious case where they are transitioning back over to a young offenders institute. So I'd like to know more of your thoughts on what that should look like for our young people.
What a therapeutic environment should look like. So I'm going to pull on my professional experience now as 38 years in the NHS. So I mean, certainly, as I said, we're incarcerating some of the most traumatised and disenfranchised young people in society to re-traumatise them or traumatise them more. I'm sure the committee is aware of the dearth of health, access to health professionals across the prison estate. And if we're talking about... I don't think any child wakes up in the morning and thinks, I think I'll go and murder someone, or I think I'll go and rape someone, What's going on with that child that's led them to, or young person, to that situation? Is it a spur of the moment decision? Is it something? Is it learned behaviour? What is it? But one of the critical services that a child would need access to is psychology services, and there just is not enough of that across our prison estate. So, I think, from my personal experience and the trauma that as a family that we've experienced, and the access to psychology services we didn't have, but we luckily had the resources to access that privately, and that's only in the last 5 years. But a child that's had, from formative years of trauma up to the date of offending, needs some pretty intensive support from very skilled professionals, and I don't think that can be offered in a prison setting. That's not how our prisons are function, or that's not what they're made up to be. So I think the whole access to a range of skilled professionals is required, as well as education, as well as taking a child from the offence to you're actually a worthwhile individual, that has a place in society. It's quite a journey to go on.
It is indeed. And thanks very much. I don't have any further questions. Okay,
thank you. And Jamie, you'd like to come back in.
Thank you, and thank you, Convener. Thank you. I've just got one or two other questions that struck me while you were speaking. I was quite taken by the story you shared about what Katie had said to you about what it's like inside a young offenders institution, the sort of people that are in there. I presume she was talking about women inmates rather than the general population.
Yeah.
So this idea that the sort of three cohorts of people, those who have been sentenced by a judge or sheriff for making a mistake in life, And something, I presume something quite serious would have had to have happened for that to be the custodial decision. Those who seem institutionalised, if you like, you know, the sort of patterns of reoffending, because they probably feel, you know, safer and more comfortable in that type of life, away from harm outside in the real world. And those who are very unwell, I presume by that do you mean traumatised or by historic experiences of adverse experiences in life and mental health?
Yes, serious and enduring mental health issues or personality disorders. Or
Okay. I mean, it's obviously quite difficult because we don't have different institutions for different types of offences or different types of people, if you like, in that respect. It's very much a one-size-fits-all environment. Do you think, and it sort of goes back to my earlier question, do you think that that is, you know, if custody has to be the solution, if that has to be the disposal that is used, is it that you could make those places better places, or that there are other places that could be? Have you done any research into international models, for example, or experiences that you might want to share with us?
Not extensive research, but I'm aware of some of the Scandinavian models that seem to be working. I mean, I don't think the prison establishment as it is just now can change. I mean, I don't think it's fair in prison officers, for example, to be experts in mental health or experts in trauma or experts, you know. That to be that, then we need to have a whole look at what prison officers are trained to be. So, you know, I think, including myself, I've given prison officers very bad press because of our experience. But you know, as you recover in your grief and trauma and you take a step back and you look at that and you think, how can a prison officer deal with a severely mentally ill woman who's perhaps displaying challenging behaviour, you know? When actually what the response that's needed, as I've said, is expert health responses. So I don't see how you would remodel. I think we've tried to do that within the prison setting. We've tried to make it something that fits all. But as Pauline said earlier, I think there needs to be a kind of root and branch look at, you know, trying not to fit this into this Victorian organisation, historical organisational structure that we have.
That's very interesting. And of course, much of the prison state is very old and antiquated and not fit for purpose in that respect to do what you asked. But the other thing that struck me was this idea that it's the first 3 months that are really vital and key, and it's not really an area we've explored. Certainly, it's not necessarily in the bill as such, but it seems to me like quite a vital period of time when someone enters into custody, whether they're adult or younger. What is not happening at the moment when someone enters custody that should be happening? What could be done better to reduce the risk involved in those first 3 months of custody?
So the figures that I gave earlier were, you know, if you look at under 25, where there was 49 deaths and 70% of them happened, 70% were suicides and 65% were in the first 3 months of the sentence. Yeah, I think it's a well-established fact now that early in sentence is a risk to someone taking their own life. What's not happening? What I don't think is happening, I don't think the current suicide prevention strategy is working. We've seen over 40% increase in suicides across the prison estate since its introduction. Interestingly enough, we've also seen an increase in death rates since the NHS took over, where you would think that would be reversed, took over responsibility for healthcare provision. So there's something not working in terms of the assessment. And again, what we're trying to do is ask a prison officer who's not a trained health professional to look, is trained in the strategy, but look for cues and clues, you know. And I have to go back to our own experience. You know, my daughter had lost 95% of her hair. She had weight loss. She had self-harming marks. She was severely distressed. I think that was a lot of cues and clues. And she was locked up and she took her own life. So, you know, there is something about it's more than cues and clues. And evidence in suicide, I'm not a suicidologist, but I have read a lot of articles and research on suicide for obvious reasons. Lots of people who are intent suicide will say, I am not suicidal.
And the final thing is, obviously, we've talked a lot in this committee about the differences between those who are held on remand versus those who are convicted. And I do appreciate there is a legal difference in being in those two different states, but it clearly comes with very differing approaches to how, what they have access to, what their rights are, what can and cannot be asked of them or offered to them. Does that need to change as well?
Absolutely. And I think even taking it back a step to the actual court process, as the sentencing guidelines are attempting to do, you know, again, our own personal experience, there were no victim issues. You know, the victim's parents in Katie's case wrote to the sheriff and requested a non-custodial sentence. And yet, you know, so there is something about the power of the judiciary in Scotland.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you very much. Linda, thank you very much for coming along to today's meeting. We appreciate your time. And I'm now going to ask for a short suspension while we change over our witnesses. Thank you. OK, thank you very much indeed. And I now welcome to our meeting Mr Jim Shields, Service Manager, and Professor Lorraine Johnson, Consultant Forensic and Clinical Psychologist at St Mary's Kenmure Secure Care Centre. Wendy Sinclair Gibbon, HM Chief Inspector of Prisons for Scotland. Gerald Michie, Governor at His Majesty's Young Offenders Institution, Polmont. And Sue Brooks, Interim Director for Strategy and Stakeholder Engagement with the Scottish Prison Service. And Alison Bavage, National Director of the Scottish Association of Social Work. So a warm welcome to you all. I intend allowing about an hour for this session, so up front, can I ask for as succinct questions and responses as possible so that we can get as many questions in. So we'll just move directly to questions, and I wonder if I can just open up with a general question, and I'm going to try to come to each of you. And I wonder if you can just give a brief overview from your organisation's perspective on what your view is on the provisions in the bill, which obviously set the cut-off point at under 18 for children who are entering the criminal justice system, and whether those that is appropriate. So I'm going to just come from my left to right, and I'll start with Sue.
So yes, the Scottish Prison Service supports the provisions of the bill. I think I was a previous governor in Polmont, and I'm sure Gerry will echo this, but working with children in a custodial setting is not the best environment. You want to do something that is age appropriate. And so our clear view is that 16 and 17 year olds are best managed in a different setting.
Okay, thanks very much.
Yeah, just to repeat that, we fully endorse the bill, the ambition, the promise that no 16 and 17 year old child should be in our care. Mm-hmm. I think it's absolutely morally the right thing to do.
OK, thank you. It's nice and succinct. Lorraine?
Yes, absolutely endorse the principles of the bills, but I would also expand that I think 18 is a rather arbitrary cut-off, and we do know that the development of the brain continues far and beyond that. We also know that the cohort of young people who will enter into the justice system have significant speech and language deficits, cognitive limitations and neurological difficulties too. Mm-hmm. So that chronological age is very different from the developmental age. So when we talk about 18, in reality, a lot of our children will present in a much younger way. And similarly, when you think post 18 into 19, 20, 21, we will not see adults as we might, you know, have a stereotype or a prototypical view of what an adult will look like. So I think it's a phenomenally good first step, but it's definitely not the finished article, and I hope it's just the building blocks.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Jim?
Yeah, I would concur. It's a welcome progression. We're definitely moving in the right direction. We're not yet aligned with the sentencing guidelines. Mm-hmm. You know, we're looking at a chronological age when we really should be focusing on the research and what we're understanding now about the developmental age of a child and the vulnerabilities that come with that. But to answer your question directly, yes, it's a welcome progression.
Thank you. Alison?
Likewise, really welcome this bill, in line with so much of what Scotland's trying to do for its young people. Completely agree. I mean, this is a knotty problem, and listening to the previous panel, you know, trying to get very definite answers to what are really knotty issues around development, age, seriousness. And I think for that reason, we kind of want to really think about brain development, what we know, neurological development, the experiences of young people who come through the justice system. You know, it's children who come into contact with the law. It's a symptom. as Kilbrandon said so long ago, it's a symptom of things usually have gone far wrong, adverse child experience, traumatic experiences. How do we as a nation move that forward into something much more progressive? So this is welcome. There are questions we'll come to later, particularly about resourcing and implementation, but absolutely in support of the direction of travel.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And Wendy.
I wish I could be so succinct. I mean, I could quite happily say, yes, I agree with all of them. You know? I mean, as you know, we produced a proposal some time ago that made exactly this. Age 18 is a first step, and I think as a first step, Scotland's to be applauded for looking at that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really important. I would like to look in future years at an individualised approach where you have someone who's 23 with a mental age of 9, it would be inappropriate to be in an adult prison. If you have a 17-year-old that has done a serious and heinous offence and is clearly very mature, perhaps an adult prison is more appropriate. And I would like to see that possibility built in, if you could. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think for me, the important thing, because we are a rights-based organisation, is you are meeting, by doing this, the UNCRC Article 1. And I think, hold on to that. That's the justification.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So, fairly good start, broadly welcoming, but with some caveats, it would appear. So, on that note, I'm just going to move straight to members and I'll bring in Colette.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to all of you. I'm going to touch upon, obviously, you're all in agreement about not having young people in young offenders institutes or adult prisons, which is good to hear. I want to touch upon secure accommodation and what I suppose is the definition of secure accommodation and why is it that you feel that it's better than putting somebody into a young offenders institute? And are they secure? What should they ideally look like? And obviously, I think Pauline alluded to earlier in our earlier session about there's not enough of them. So I think, where will I start? Sorry, there's six people to choose from. I don't know if anyone has a strong enough opinion they want to come in on this. So
perhaps I should start
from our
perspective. So, the prison service has travelled some distance in terms of trying to become more trauma-informed in providing more training for our staff. But I think we fundamentally take the view that as Wendy said, the issue really is one about children's rights and that taking decisions about the best interest of the child is the right thing to do. Prisons, by their very nature, are custodial environments. They're not purpose-built, certainly for that age group. They can be quite busy places. The staff to young people ratio in secure units is much higher. There's a far greater depth of a skills base around things like child development and attachment. And so for those reasons, really, we think it's more appropriate. I don't know if Gerry wants to add to that.
Yeah, I mean, we were downstairs a little while ago and a very similar question came up and we talked about the physical environment of a prison. So prisons, by their very nature, as Sue says, are incredibly large establishments. Pullman itself has a design capacity around 800. They are large cellular halls. Today, there are 7 children in our care in Scottish prisons, 5 young men. They are in a half a gallery, 44 single cells. They have young offenders below them and above them. Prisons can be quite noisy, busy places, etc. So in terms of the environment, we try to do our best to soften the environment in which we keep the young men. 5 young men, 2 young women in the prison setting, but they are by definition much bigger, much busier, and you can see a child in a Scottish prison. They're not difficult to identify.
Yep.
Jim and Lorraine, come in just from the secure care perspective.
The environment, secure care exists to care for children. I mean, that's not to say prison guards don't care, but their primary role is to provide care and protection. The vulnerability for young people in secure care broadens beyond the criminogenic need, which we're really mainly discussing today, but we support children with their welfare needs. The demographic of young people within secure care is broadening at both ends, so we're broadening it, looking, you know, the 16 and 17 year olds possibly going on to 19, and we're seeing traumatised children as young as 12. That's where the skill set lies, and that's the environment that, that we respond to. Secure care, as it is just now, is an advantage of YOI. We're prepared for the young people that are coming through and familiar with them. However, there's still a journey for it to go. You know, there's still, if we are going to work with the critical few around the vulnerabilities and risk management, then we need support to do that. But we're best placed in that we work in smaller environments in line with the promise and what's expected from the promise. We adopt a residential care approach and a kind of family type environment within the constraints. It's definitely focused on care. However, we recognise that we are there for risk management and the safety of the young people there, but then the broader safety of the community. So there's a broad responsibility on secure care, and it's just about to broaden.
Thank you. So I'll try and be succinct, but I have to be honest and say that I've probably spent 20 years thinking about an answer to that question. So I think secure care definitely has the potential to do something transformational for children. But you need to have the right physical environment, you need to have the right relational environment, and you need to have procedures that are trauma-informed, child-informed and family-informed. So for me, the vision isn't really that complex. You have a purpose-built facility that resembles a community resource. It's a house, it's small units. It has a kitchen, it has a sitting room, it has a bathroom, it has access to, you know, within the perimeter fence, so to speak, access to education, socialisation opportunities. So you normalise that as much as possible, because I think in contrast to a prison setting, we often remove the opportunity to build the skills that we require people to reduce recidivism rates, so to speak. So you have that. But absolutely critical, your staffing, their skills, their knowledge is absolutely critical. And I think front end, so I was listening to the previous session, you have individualised assessments and formulations. Now, that incorporates risk, and you work with the risk, you tolerate the risks, the complexity of the risks. But across time, when you do assessments in these children, you do tend to find three or four pretty common trajectories. So you have the children who've got lots of adverse childhood experiences. You have children with really complex neurodevelopmental profiles, but they're not quite at the threshold to get into health services, or their social circumstances don't allow it. They're moved around the country. You have delinquency type profiles, you know, through virtue of socialisation, maybe coming from criminogenic families, so that's a pathway. And you also have the critical few, which I would articulate are your unusual presentations, low base rate, but major impact. You know, the ones that define your case law thereafter. So coming into secure care, you need to have an environment that is healthy and conducive to child development. You need to have opportunities that promote socialisation, but you absolutely must have skilled staff that can recognise what trajectory the kid is on and wax and wane to meet that need. So big assessments and formulations, and I don't mean by any stretch of the imagination time intensive, because we do ours within a fortnight, which, and you know, I have a background in health service, worked in CAMHS for many years. We are lean because we know we need to get it right. You have a small window of opportunity with these kids to engage them. They'll work out quickly if you're their in-group or out-group. You know, they'll test you. So you work really intensively, get as good an understanding as you can, work out what their needs are, get them on board and deliver. But, you know, there's an approach in England called the Secure Stairs approach. And one of the strap lines is every interaction matters. And it's from the smile that you give the young person into the door. It's how you react to them when they're high risk. It's how you recognise them when they're distressed or when they're just being teenagers and they're pushing the limits. So in my view, because I've probably spent most of my career thinking about that question, I think it's absolutely achievable. I do think it can produce good outcomes, but there is a real reality about investment and resourcing and also seeing it as a part of a pathway, because secure care gets maligned quite a lot. We're a necessary evil, I would say. I'd be happy for my role to become obsolete, but it's part of a necessary pathway. So with that in mind, there are lots of principles, research, evidence, experience across our own country and the world that we can draw on, I think, to make something quite transformational.
Can I quickly just come in on what you've just said there? Thank you, convener. It's just that, you know, obviously, my next question was going to be anyway, was about, the, you know, preparing the young person, and you've seen that trajectory and pathway as well. Do you think then we would be setting them back in terms of their transition, depending on their sentencing, obviously, and the disposal they've got, setting them back by putting them in a Young Offenders Institute as they go through their sentence?
So I think Wendy's comment is absolutely right. We need to individualise care planning. And the ideal would be that we would have a suite of resources that could meet the need from the first formulation and the individualised need going forward. And I can tell you, being professionally, there is nothing more frustrating than getting through two-thirds of a care plan and somebody being moved to some other organisation. With the best will in the world, the transition isn't there. In the reality of working with young people in secure care, you might literally have to play Connect Four with them for 4 months before they'll speak to you. And then they're brave enough to speak to you, and 2 months later, they're moved. So if there was a way to envisage a future where it was a needs-led care plan suite of options, some young people do need to go into the criminal justice system. It is the right place for them. Some people need much more bespoke, low-sensory, you know, high-support interventions. Some people need trauma-informed places where they can heal and recover as their brain allows that to happen. So I would absolutely agree.
There's a lot to cover. I wonder if I can maybe just, in the spirit of timekeeping, maybe just bring Wendy in on that.
Yeah, I mean, for me, there's a primary consideration, which is the victim of the offence, OK? And I'm not arguing that children aren't victims. They often are, in fact, frequently are. But at the end of the day, that person's going to be released back into the community, and what you want to do is reduce the risk of that person going back into the community. That's the primary consideration. If you look at the difference between how prisons are funded and resourced. So prison staff have about 12 weeks training and then extra bits added on. Staff in secure care have full social work training and have to be accredited by the General Teaching Council or the Social Services Council. Big difference. Prisons are inspected once every 4 years. Secure care is inspected every year. The staff-child ratios are completely different. They are so much more in favour of secure care. So in terms of straight facts, you've got the human rights pathways, you've got the standards, all of those wonderful things which they share. But in straight facts, are you more likely to reduce the risk if you are concentrating intensely on that child at the early stage of their offending, even if it's a serious offence? Or are you more likely to do that in a prison? And I think the answer is clear. Secure care offers that opportunity.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Pauline and then Russell.
Thank you very much. Good morning. So I'm interested to explore the question that some of you said that it's a good first step. So implying that we should go beyond 18, and this is, you might have heard earlier, this is what I'm struggling with. So I'm open-minded about that, but I'm struggling with understanding how we'd organise the estate. So, I mean, does it imply then, because Kate Wallace came back to me and said, well, you don't want to reinvent a young offenders institution if you do. But Professor Johnson, when you were talking about children, and that's why we're doing this, because we are signed up to the conventions and the rights of the child, which is a child to 18, but you're not a child between the ages of 21. Now, notwithstanding, don't need to come back at me, but I understand all the research about brain development up to 25, which has implications for lots of policy areas. But if we were to extend it beyond 18, I'm wondering then how we can do it in the current configuration. And does that in effect then argue for the abolition of, or at least if you went up to 25, the abolition of a young offenders institution? Don't know if the prison service want to start.
Yeah, so I think that there are a number of interesting issues about how you manage transitions and maybe some factual information first. So I think one of the important things to know is that the children who come into us at the minute are very often quite close to their 18th birthday, and mm-hmm. the majority of them in any event are on remand. We certainly echo the issues that people have raised about the background of abuse and trauma and victimisation that they have experienced. Of the children who come in, many of them, of the very small number, they have, though, committed really quite serious offences because, happily, lots of other alternatives have been explored before they get to us. So they have committed quite serious offences. It's absolutely right that children should be in the, a secure unit setting, an appropriate, an age-appropriate setting. But at the minute, the pathway would still bring them into us at some appropriate point. And that's why we think it's quite important that the age range within the bill allows flexibility around that.
So your position is you're content with the bill as it is. Yeah. You wouldn't go beyond 18, which is what I'm...
No, I was going to kind of come on to that. So we do think it's really important that there is flexibility because maturity is quite different at different ages. My own view is that you can see exactly the same issues for the children reflected in the slightly older population, certainly in age 18 to 21, and that's partly why we also keep some of those up to age 23 in Pullman. And in recent years, I know you know this, some have visited, we have done some really fabulous work with the women's population in engaging in a discussion around what a different model of custody in that instance would be. And that has led to some really innovative work and indeed, the potential, the opening of HM Prison Stirling in the summer and the community custody units. So I suppose I don't have a kind of a specific view either way, except to say that I would agree with Wendy and others that there is room for a discussion around what that would mean based on the evidence, because I think the 18 to 21 year olds have a very similar background, and many of them have been in care, they've got all sorts of
but they're not children, and this is what I'm only pinpointing. This, they're not children, and the whole basis of the bill, I don't want to sound like I'm against this, but I just want clarity. We're not talking about children, so if we support a different policy, I just wanted to be clear.
I think that's
so. Your position is that
there are kind of obviously balance of rights issues between people who offend and victims. Mm-hmm. I understand that, and I understand the definition of a child versus an adult. So I'm not necessarily saying that the model should be continuation in secure care.
Right.
But what I am saying is I think there is space for a discussion around the needs of the older age group. That we could engage around together.
That's helpful. Gerald, do you
have nothing further to add? Thank you.
Thanks. Professor?
I think we have to start somewhere, and you have to take a pragmatic decision at some point. So I think 18 is in line with the UNCRC, but I would completely echo that. Just as long as we just don't think that's sorted, there's another cohort, and I think that 18 to 21 year old cohort is particularly vulnerable. Very often that's when children are born, pregnancy starts, the way that age, there's lots of risks there. It should just be part of a pathway that's much more sensitive to the to people's developmental stage.
Thank you.
Yeah, I share that opinion. As part of a pathway, you need to draw a line somewhere. But the 18 to 21 is a vulnerable group. There's an increased level of offending within there. But there's other discussions we've got to have around it, and some of those discussions have existed within the sentencing guidelines, and those discussions then need to continue around assessment prior to sentencing, assessment during sentencing remand periods, such as the formulation model, and assessment around transitions. So there is, the discussions exist, but they need to be broader. But I do think we need to have a line somewhere with it for the purpose of law.
Thank you.
I think one of the kind of the most obvious issues around this, and let's get back to the resources, is how much we spend on people in prison and how much secure care costs. And there, we've heard some of the really good reasons for this. Then what we have, by having any age limit, is a cliff edge. And that's partly the way that we arrange our prisons. You heard from Linda this morning and from people on this panel, which is that prison is not a therapeutic environment, it's a custodial environment. There's been work done on health and social care in prisons, and one of the big gaps that we know that there is in prison is the capacity for anybody in prison to have the same kind of social care and social work assessment, adult social support assessment, as people in the community. Okay, so there are options here in terms of how we smooth the transitions by not having these hard edges, but by also looking about what comes next. Okay, and that if we could get the support more effectively into prisons for adults, not only would we do what Wendy's talking about, which is about assure victims that people who go into custodial environments will return to the community, hopefully in a better place than when they left, which they don't at the moment. Let's be very, you know, very clear about that. Our through care is not strong enough, is not supportive enough, and is not well-resourced enough. So this requires us not to think about... We have to think about the whole system and the custodial lifespan, if you like. We have to, as people are talking about, make sure that transitions are smooth, that we do careful and minimal transitions. One of the words that nobody has said yet about secure care is about, you know, our brains, particularly when we're young, but all the way through our lives, need nurture and need love if they are to repair, improve, become secure, become attached, able to have relationships, able to manage difficult events in our lives in a way that doesn't harm our mental health or where we need to resort to substances. So I suppose that's my message, is that whatever cut-off we have, we also have to think about what comes next, how we reduce those transitions, how we take a really social model, which is what secure care is trying to do. It looks at the person, but doesn't just look at what they've done. It looks at beyond them. It looks at their family, their education, their hopes, their aspirations, their talents, how they're spending their days. You know, and that's what makes it different. But I would really like, on behalf of, kind of, I suppose, the promise, to talk about love and attachment and relationships through this and not having that hard edge. And there's things we can do.
Thank you very much. Wendy?
I just think it's a brilliant first step. Let's get, you know, legislation with the European Convention on getting under-18s out of prison. And let's look at transitions and look at individualising it a bit afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Can I just thank the witnesses for that answer? I think I have got some clarity there that it's a discussion we need to have, but there's a lot of things we need to work out, which is the transitions and flexibility. Because I know that up to the age of 19 you have some flexibility, and I think that was helpful to know that in Poland you've got some flexibility there beyond the age of 21. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Bring in Russell, followed by Rona.
Thank you. Now, this may be a fairly obvious question, but in terms of secure accommodation, what is the current provision in Scotland? Is it just St Mary's, or are there a number of facilities?
84 beds across Scotland. There's 4 charitable-run secure centres and 1 in Edinburgh, a 6-bedded, and that's run by the local authority.
St Mary's the largest of the...
St Mary's has a capacity for 24 children.
Okay. Now, another thing about secure accommodation is what restrictions are there on those who you're caring for? Can individuals leave at any point?
No, the progression... There's 3 different ways children are secured. So they can be secured through the court, whether that be through remand or sentencing. They can be detained through the children's hearing, and that gives a responsibility and onus on the local authority, or they can be cross-border, which I know is a discussion that exists around the bill. So children can work towards what's traditionally described as mobility, but the actual day-to-day care is within the secure environment. You know, they are detained. It's a locked campus at night. It's you know, it's locked doors. But when we speak about a trauma-informed environment, we understand there's traumatising aspects of it as well. But it's very much detention for young people. And
One thing we hear from the police quite frequently is high numbers of children absconding from facilities like this. Is that a particular problem? Or?
Not. You'll hear about... So we're involved in a programme which is called the Respect Programme. It's talking about children who abscond from care arrangements. That's not necessarily reflective in secure care. Right. I, in my time in secure care, I've not known anybody to abscond from the secure campus. We may have somebody try to abscond on a transition, whether that be a hospital visit or leaving or coming to secure care. But, you know, we work. Our security, our environmental security, requires improvement. It requires resources. You know, we're a 23, 24-year-old service, and that needs, you know, we need to create improved environmental safety for young people, particularly with the intention of the bill. However, absconding isn't a, you know, as in, for want of a better expression, breaking out of secure is not a common situation.
Right. Yeah,
it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen regularly, and I know it doesn't happen regularly across other centres either.
Yeah, thank you. There was also evidence from St Mary's about a lack of funding. I think the quote was, it's uncertain, underfunded and largely undermined, that being the provision.
Yeah, I think there's a very simple start here. You know, where you're looking about to move from a prison service or, you know, that's funded, essentially government funded, to something that's a charity that requires, you know, beds to be full to maintain the level of service. You know, there's a precarious resourcing issue around secure care.
And if this bill comes to pass, you expect more people to be using your service?
Yes.
Yeah. And you've projected what that might look like in the funding that will be required, and that needs to be funded by government.
There needs to be certainty. So, Lorraine, would you like to add to this?
So we currently operate what's referred to as a bed rate. So there's an amount allocated to us from Scottish Excel, and that's our bed rate. That's what we get per child, so to speak. And in order for the facility to become viable, we have to have a percentage occupancy to enable it to become viable, because obviously we need to have staff for X number of children, we need to have staff for X number of resources. So if you fall below your occupancy, your organisation starts to run in deficit. So we have had, it waxes and wanes, obviously. However, more recently, and I think you've heard it from others, that there has been cross-border placements. We have relied on cross-border placements at times to ensure the financial sustainability of the resource so that we can then meet the needs of our Scottish children too. So it is, for the type of intent, you know, what is possible, the principles, you need to invest in the buildings. We want trauma-informed security, but we don't want cameras in children's dining rooms or bedrooms. You know, it has to be discreet. These things cost money. But we also need to have highly trained staff. You need to recruit staff, retain staff, and the current bed rate just doesn't really allow that to happen.
Because the written evidence was that the authorities elsewhere in the UK are willing to pay more than the set rate in Scotland.
Yes, so we, again, this is just a pure anecdote, but we have had a lot of success with one particular local authority in England. You know, crime changes, children are criminally exploited, sometimes we need to interrupt gang affiliation, so coming to Scotland is a good option for them. And we've delivered well for them. They pay significantly more for a bed than Scottish local authorities, and we are one of their preferred providers now because of the work we do.
Roughly percentage terms, how much more would they be paying?
Precisely, thousands.
You're looking at least 35% of an uplift from English providers from what the Scotland Excel rate is.
Right. So that, obviously, whatever happens with this bill, that needs looked at.
Yeah, that certainly looks looked at. And it also gives us, with the cross-border arrangement, it means we can be more bespoke and more assessment-led. because we can be determining the level of need and support and the staff that we are required, the staff and resources required to meet the individual need and risk. We don't have that luxury within the Scottish arrangement.
Can I just say as well that one other thing that's really a really important piece of learning from the English cases is we generally agree a care plan. So sometimes those care plans will be 9 months and they're not really interrupted. So we get to start and finish the job, so to speak. That's not always the case with our local authorities in Scotland.
Right, that's interesting. Thank you. I've got a question for... a couple of questions for Alison. One of them is an extension on what you referred to a moment ago about exploitation of young people. In the proposal, there's a suggestion that anyone aged 16 plus in police custody can nominate another adult other than the parent to be notified of their situation. I just wonder if there's any consideration being given to the risk to vulnerable children in that situation, that they could be contacting people who are exploiting them, whether it be organised crime or others?
I think that is one of the issues that needs to be worked through, that that's an issue with vulnerable adults, also, adults beyond 18. We do need to give children opportunities to have some control. However, I think that with good support from the police and good relationships with the local social work departments, I think there are definitely risks. But all of these things need to be balanced quite carefully.
Yeah. Thank you. And final question, if that's OK. Earlier on, Victim Support Scotland talked about children who are harmed by other children having no right to any information whatsoever. It seems to be a complete vacuum of information. And as you know, your members will represent or assist families on both sides of these particular scenarios. Can you see a way that the bill, or should the bill address this? And if so, what should it do? A lot more transparency around children's hearings or what?
It depends what we mean by transparency. Does that mean greater understanding of how the systems work and some sort of light or looking at the type of information that victims receive? It's very clear from what Kate was saying earlier today, Kate Wallace, that there is a significant gap for people who have had crimes committed against them by children. This is the balance of people's rights. And again, this is where it gets knotty, and where depending on the situations of whether it's a young person who's a victim or the young person who's perpetrated a crime, that the balance of both of those needs and the safety of those people to grow up with as much anonymity and psychological safety as we can give them is absolutely important. I think it'll be interesting to look across the border and see what's happening in the children's courts in England as things open up there in terms of reporting a bit more on how that's being managed. I'm afraid I'm not able to give you a lot of detail on that, but it's something that maybe we should look at and look at other models where there is a level of greater transparency and greater perhaps understanding in the general public how things work for children. And it's not that children are getting off, if you like. That's the wrong way of putting it. We need to reframe in terms of how services are supporting children, both who've been victims and who have committed crimes, to live safe and positive lives in the future.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Before I bring in Rona, I'd just like to... let members and witnesses know that I can extend this session. We're covering a lot of important ground, and I'm very keen that as many questions and responses can take place. So on that basis, assuming our witnesses are able to stay a little bit longer if required, then I will extend the session and if needs be, we'll reschedule our final agenda item to just after Easter recess. So I take it that that is acceptable for you. Perfect. On that basis, I'll bring in Rona McKay and then Jamie.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to address my questions to Jim and Lorraine specifically. Just to say that St Mary's is in my constituency and I've visited it many times over the past 7 years and always impressed by the ethos and the caring aspect of it. You know, I think the work that's done there is fantastic. That said, can I ask both of you if you think it is a place for serious young offenders who have committed very serious crimes? Can I have your response to that?
I think it has the potential. I think there is a reality check around what that might look like. So some young people come to us with, you know, terrible index offences or offences, but actually they're very easy to manage because it's a sort of criminogenic need, it's a cultural need, it's an offence that happens when they're with peers and intoxicated, and none of these things really present themselves in the secure estate. So in general terms, for most young people who present serious risk, yes. There are, however, the exceptional cases, and I think that's where some thinking needs to happen. So, you know, cases maybe involving a child murder or, you know, something really unusual but very, very concerning. And there you have a different type of risk that presents to, because some of the young people will take great umbrage that other person too. So you actually introduce a whole new set of risks to manage in the secure unit. So just, you know, some of the thinking we've had around that is that, so you get these rare cases of really low frequency but high impact, and you also get some young people who are incredibly distressed. So I call that the acute risk. So they're very maybe suicidal, really dysregulated, and they need a real period of stabilisation. So within the campus, we've certainly spoken about you probably do need a space that maybe allows for that young person to be there for a period of weeks to get the relational security, to get them stabilised, and then really think about how you would reintegrate. So, you know, we would need some physical modifications to enable that to happen. But I think, again, it's about care planning. It's not about defining a care plan by the offence they committed. That's maybe the top line, but then bringing them in and say, OK, so what are your risks? What are your vulnerabilities? What is the risk to you here as well? And managing that. And I think with some environmental restructuring and some training for our staff, we would be well positioned to balance that tension.
That's interesting, yeah. And as you say, it is very rare. But it was just before, I think Kate Wallace had intimated some concerns about that. But Jim, do you have anything to...
You know, we are familiar with working with young people who have committed the most serious offences. And as Lorraine said, these are not necessarily young people that are most difficult to manage. So, yes, you know, secure care is the environment, and it can be the environment to do that.
Okay.
Where you have where you need the professionalism and the input is the harm they can have on the therapeutic environment for the other young people. You know, I spoke about the broad demographic of young people in secure care, and there is cross-contamination. So you create that vulnerability, cross-contamination of vulnerabilities. What we're needing is that can be resolved through vigilance and good care and professionalism. What we'd be wanting as an outcome of the bill is to increase the professionalisation of secure care, to give it the status that the critical few merit.
Sure.
Do you know, that they have the status and the ability to deliver that care and the environmental safety and the professional approach.
Okay.
Could I add something, just because I think it builds on the previous panel too. So we do have psychology in our and very considerable access in comparison to what you might get in the community. And for some of our high risk people, they will have one or two sessions a day. You know, that and I don't mean an hour, I mean there will be a really intensive co-regulation modelling to them, modelling to the staff. And that is the type of resource that you require. So there's the environmental part, but really people, really, you know, child-informed specialists, mm-hmm. but also the no risk mm-hmm. as well, mm-hmm. and having access to that really intensive at the front where you understand them and then regulate them back in mm-hmm. to normalisation. Mm-hmm. But we would need a facility to manage that really acute and high mm-hmm. risk.
Yeah. What's the average, if there is an average, length of time that a child would spend in your secure care?
It varies. And bear in mind, you know, as I've mentioned, there's three methods for young, or three journeys that young people can take to come into secure care. Mm-hmm. And we do have such a broad variation of need. Mm-hmm. There's young people who will need care well beyond secure care, you know, mm-hmm. And what we're doing is formulating, supporting, creating safety and stabilisation, mm-hmm. and making that a shorter journey by supporting mm-hmm. the people who are going to take the care into the community. Mm-hmm. There's other young people that need a much more intensive level of support mm-hmm. over a longer period of time.
Yeah.
And then we've got to talk about community safety. You know, there's young people who have a criminogenic need or they're a risk to others, and they require that level of supervision that perhaps only secure can offer, or YOI, actually.
Yeah. And I think some people, it's my point about secure care being maligned, and it probably should be in lots of ways, but we have young people who just do not want to leave us. Yeah. They absolutely don't want to leave.
Do they become dependent?
Well, yes, because it's the first time that they've had an environment where they're safe, an yes. environment uh-huh. where there's predictability,
uh-huh.
where they're loved, they're nurtured, they're mm-hmm. educated. Mm-hmm. And we have had young people very clearly say to us, as soon as I go out, you know, I won't be out for long, or I'll see you on Friday, you know, and you know that they're going off, and they will. They'll either put themselves at risk or they will cause harm, and they will come back to us. I think we've got one young person in their third admission with us.
Not both it was case specific. This was previously referred to as institutionalised, but it's young people establishing a core belief. This is the only environment that can keep them safe. Uh-huh. And what we, you know, through assessment intervention, what we need to do is shift the notion that it's bricks and mortar that keeps mm-hmm. them safe, but it's people and relationships mm-hmm. and believing in their assessment and believing in mm-hmm. their understanding. Yeah. And that takes, you know, that takes a very skilled workforce and a lot of trust mm-hmm. to develop that. Yeah. And going back to the points Alison made as well.
And as I repeat, I can only see skill and care whenever I've visited. It's quite astonishing. Just finally, just if I could go back to the cross-border issue and the issue of capacity and finance, etc. Is it the case that there are some young people in Scotland who can't get a place because of your need to take in cross-border for financial reasons?
Not currently.
Has it been the case in the past?
I understand it has been the case in the past. Mm-hmm. We do have the pilot with the Scottish Government just now for the purchase of the last bed. That has been, it's only 3 months in practice. It's been hugely successful. The impact of that means all our recent admissions, and I'm looking over the 3 month period, I think with the exception of one, have been Scottish. So then,
sorry, can you explain what purchase of the last bed means? I'm not sure.
So the Scottish Government have an agreement with the four, I'm not sure where it stands with Edinburgh, but the four secure centres, that the last bed is purchased, so that's available for a Scottish bed for a young person who requires secure care, whether that's coming from, you know, the court, or whether it's coming from the children's hearing or initially social work authorisation, that bed should be available, you know, across, you know, there should be four beds sitting across the centres. However, we're now at capacity, so our last bed is no longer available.
Okay.
I think you can predict we may be coming back to a point of saturation, possibly. We're seeing an increase in youth offending. We're seeing a kind of a fallout of COVID. You know, we've got a cohort of young people who have missed universal services, have missed the opportunities for socialisation. So that would indicate we're going to get a spike in what would be delinquent behaviour and antisocial behaviours, and we're also seeing a insurgence of criminal exploitation and sexual exploitation, and the time it takes us to get a handle on this as a country and as a response, we can expect there'll be an increased need for secure care as a result.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Can I maybe just pick up on a point that you made early on, Lorraine, in your response, which was basically that secure care centres potentially could accommodate serious young offenders, but that would need restructuring and training. So are you aware if there has been, or have you had any engagement with the Scottish Government around the potential or what would be necessary in terms of the additional resources required for that?
We hosted a meeting, so we've had discussions around it, but we certainly haven't put together a very well thought out detailed proposal, which I think it would be. So just to clarify, what I would say is we can manage core delinquency. That is what we do. It's not an issue. The additionality would be for the low base rate, high impact crimes that hit the media, and they're very emotive, and also your really, really high acute risk, although I think we are actually very good at managing acute risk. So there's additional training around the criminogenic risk need and the tension of balancing risk with children. You know, some people struggle to see a child as risky, and then other philosophies will see the risk. So there's just a bit of work to be done to bring people into the centre, hold the risk in mind, work with the child, but don't get pulled in either way. So that's quite a common dynamic that you see across closed settings. So you just need a bit of training. But we have communicated this to the government, and I think it would be really helpful to sit down and look at what that would look like.
Yeah, thank you. Jamie.
Okay, I'm going to start with Gerald, if you don't mind. So you made a comment earlier. You said there are 7 children in your prison estate.
Yes.
How do you define children?
It's 16 and 17-year-old. So that's 2 females and 5 male young men in the estate at this moment in time. That one English, and that was a young man who committed an offence in Scotland, was bailed, but he has an English recall, so he's waiting to be transferred back down to the English estate. Okay. And we currently have one of the females, HMP Grampian, can legally hold female children, so there's one female in Grampian. All of the people in my care at this moment in time have came into custody since the 3rd of January, and the last one came in on the 23rd of March. There are 4 18 birthdays in the next half a dozen weeks, so when they go through their 18th birthday, they will actually transition into the YOI part of the establishment.
From where? From which part of the establishment where?
We keep young men in terms of the residential and sleeping accommodation separate for the rest of the YO population. So children sleep in different accommodation from the young offenders.
Okay. So here's my question then. Of the 84 beds of secure accommodation which are designed to cater for, under the existing legislation, 16 and 17-year-olds, how many of those beds are available or were available at the time that people were placed into Pullman? I'm trying to understand why you have people.
All of the ones that young people can arrive at us 2 ways. So there's the 16 and 17-year-olds who transition from secure to the prison estate, and that is a really well-planned, well-orchestrated, supportive journey between the secure provider and herself. Often we have up to 6 months to plan, and that will include site visits and personal officer visits and relationship building as we move across. We don't take children from the hearing system. We'll take children from the criminal justice system, and they often come to us unannounced at very short notice, and the majority are on remand.
OK, so none of the people that you have in Pullman are there as a result of lack of capacity and secure accommodation?
I don't know the answer to that.
Who made the decision to put them in Pullman?
The sheriff.
Does the sheriff assign people to specific institutions or just remand or hold them in custody? And then it's up. Who makes the decision as to where people go, effectively?
So Pullman is the national holding facility for young offenders and male children in Scotland,
right.
And female young offenders and a female child would normally go to HMP Cotton Vale, and they will go to the new HMP Stirling, but Grampian can legally also hold for the distance. In terms of north east of Scotland, Grampian can also hold a female child.
Okay, but you don't think they should be there?
In the prison estate? No, I think we all agree, the prison service agrees with the ambition of the bill.
Right, but the problem is, if the bill was passed tomorrow, we couldn't move those people to secure accommodation because there's no capacity. Capacity has been used up by people from other local authorities in other parts of the UK who are paying more. Therefore, there would need to be a pretty substantial change to secure accommodation to accommodate that direction of travel.
No.
There is capacity. Okay. Right, so you could accommodate a fairly substantive change to how and where people are placed immediately, yeah.
Yes, I have there's vacancies, so there's a website
okay,
called the SAN website that on a daily basis updates the number of beds, if you like,
yeah.
That are available across the secure estate. So, yeah, there's currently vacancies.
There's about 11 at the moment.
There's 11 at the moment,
yeah. The last look that we had. But I think you're hitting on a really important point, which is capacity. and because there is a wider system where we cannot necessarily plan for or articulate what future demand is actually going to be, mm-hmm. and there are so many decision points in the variety of systems, that one of the things, if this bill is to work, and we all want it to, it's definitely the right direction, is making sure that not only is there capacity in secure care estate, because what happens, I mean, one of my questions is, so what happens if that's full up?
Well, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
where will young people end up? And that's one of the questions that we need to think about. But also beyond that, because if you have, and you'll have heard from other people, more people coming through the hearing systems, more people having social services, social work and social care support for much longer. Mm. There is a big capacity issue here. I sit on the board of Social Work Scotland, and I know in that their response to the Care and Justice Bill is that we probably need around 176 social workers. Now, that's no small amount when you have the pressure on a workforce that is really struggling to recruit and retain at the moment, that is already working at crisis management.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and what happens and what happens to the preventative and supportive work that we all needs to happen to hopefully prevent people coming into secure. So there, I mean, you know, to use the whole systems approach as a kind of a program methodology, rather than a particular piece of work, is we need to look at all the steps within this bill that is quite rightly pushing children to community services. Absolutely the right thing to do. But if we're to hold them and support them and their families, in keeping with the UNCRC and the promise and the rest of it, there is a significant amount of resourcing for social work and social care for local authorities and capacity for the residential and the secure systems.
I guess what I'm trying to get my head around, I'd really appreciate your feedback there, and I think all of that will be noted when we look at perhaps the financial memorandum around the legislation and its implications. But and you may have picked this up from the previous panel as trying to get my head around what you think the role of young offenders institutions are in Scotland. And certainly if there's a general agreement that it's not the place for 16 and 17-year-olds, and perhaps even older, depending on the direction of travel of this bill, then what type of people ought to be held in YOIs in Scotland? Is it around age? Is it around the nature of the offence? Is it around their perceived risk to the public or victims? I mean, it's quite hard to get your head around what sort of environment it should be. And I guess that's maybe a question for government, because they're the people who ultimately control what institutions are around. But
can I just... I know that, Sue, you're wanting to come in, so I don't know if you want to roll it into Jamie's follow-up question.
Yes,
or
So before that, just on the issue about kind of numbers and variability, maybe just a couple of things that might help, and then I'll come on to the other issue that you're asked. Mm-hmm. So the kind of statistical average, really, for young people, 16, 17-year-olds with us, is around about 14, although it has year-on-year gone down. And at the minute, as Gerry's saying, we have only seven. In terms of throughput, though, annually there's around about 60 young people who kind of experience that that kind of custodial environment. And there is some variability. So, you know, from time to time we might have no girls and maybe only two boys. And then at other times, you know, you're up to 7, 8, 9. In fact, post-January, I think we were up to about 12, was it? Yeah. So the secure, although there is overall kind of capacity, would need to be able to manage those variability issues. So that's something I think to think about. In terms of the kind of issue about what is prison for, and I suppose going back to some of the discussions about the 18 to 21 year olds, I mean, you know, as I said earlier, that we have gone for a new model of custody for women, and that was informed by a very comprehensive evidence base and a broad consultation with, you know, lots of people, specialists from across different sectors in order to inform that. So I don't think there's an easy answer to exactly what that would look like for the slightly older age group. And as people have rightly identified, there are competing rights issues. So I suppose it's back to that issue about we'd need to stand back, create a space in which that discussion could take place based on the evidence. And I do think a couple of other folk have commented on the fact that, you know, that's in many respects, it's a system issue. It's not just a prisons issue. So we would need to take account of lots of different perspectives in order to get to a position about what is most effective, what is most appropriate, and what balances the rights. I don't know if that helps at all.
It does, thank you very much. Gerald, you obviously spend your day in, day out in this environment, and will have a lot of experience as to the types of people coming in and under your care. You may have heard the feedback from a previous witness about what she thought the different cohorts of people were. Is it your experience that you believe that the Young Offenders Institution as an environment is the right place for the types of people that are being placed into custody there? Or is it simply that you know you'd like to be able to do more in certain areas but are perhaps restricted by either people's, you know, legal status, for example. Yeah.
The Scottish Prison Service are contracted. We anybody committed by the courts come into our care. And I think that at times we have a very difficult and challenging journey with some of those people. The previous panel, a very emotive regarding a personal experience. And undoubtedly, we have a number of women in our care in particular that are extremely unwell, whether that's physical or mental health issues, and our kind of providers in terms of NHS, mental health services, etc., we do the absolute best that we can. The women's environments actually can tend to be more traumatic, noisier, more difficult than some of the male environments. And that can be quite distressing for people coming in to the custody for the very first time. Young men are very active. They're quite loud. They're quite boisterous, etc. So prisons have quite a buzz about it. It's really quite interesting because a lot of the people who transition to us from secure are ready and able to make that journey. In fact, some of them see it as a natural stepping stone in their life journey, etc. But often in secure care providers will experience it. We can receive admissions at 8 o'clock, at 10 o'clock, at 2 o'clock in the morning. Well, a young person committed on a warrant, and our job is absolutely for the next 24, 48, 72 hours to keep them safe, to keep them well, to see their immediate needs. And that's incredibly difficult for us. And we lose people in terms of they go back out before we can even make a dent. I think colleagues had said that. Numerous overnighters arriving at 5, 6 at night and going back to court the next morning. I did some number crunching just yesterday, and I think apart from one young person who spent 7 months and 8 days with us, the average time with us is 11 days. and how much we can impact on that person. Immediate needs, a care plan, safety, security, family contact, physical health, nutrition are what we concentrate on.
Yep. There's obviously been quite a lot of criticism, and I don't think it's all directed necessarily to individuals who work in terms of the prison officers. We know the huge amount of pressure and stress they're all under. But nonetheless, there are some stark statistics around suicides amongst young people in custody. Do you have a view on that? Is that something that is preventable? Is it something that is inevitable? Or is it indeed something that you think could be improved but would require a huge amount of further investment and resource?
Any death in our care is absolutely tragic. We should attempt as an organisation, as a society, to prevent any death in custody. The expert review of mental health that happened a couple of years ago, we have worked behind the scenes with the Chief Inspector's Office, CYCJ, we're developing new strategies, etc., to support those in our care. We are looking at, I think Lorraine and Jim talked about training staff. So, you know, we train prison officers, and then dependent on the population that they work with, if you're working with young people, we've got specific young people in custody training, women in custody training, trauma-informed training from the chief executive of the organisation right down to our kind of support staff, mental health first aid, and even a kind of trauma-informed approach to laying hands on. We don't search now in terms of laying physical hands on. We have the ability to bring people into the establishment without traumatic searching, etc., etc. So we're working really hard, and we continue to work with partners to make the prison a safer, more trauma-free environment.
Thank you, Anna. Appreciate those efforts. Just one final question for Wendy.
I was just going to bring in Wendy.
Yeah,
on
well, that's perfect timing. Yeah, because I was really intrigued by a comment I think you made at the very opening of the session, is that obviously the bill takes quite a prescriptive approach and black and white. It's an age-based parameter approach, whereas I seem to get the impression that there may be other factors that could come into play or should come into play when determining where the best places that a one-size-fits-all approach or this form of progression from one institution to another as the age is the only way of dealing with it. The scenario you painted, that it'd be entirely inappropriate, for example, of a 24-year-old with serious developmental issues, for example, to be in an adult prison, but equally it'd be entirely inappropriate for a 24-year-old who is of sound mind and committed a very serious offence of assault, murder or rape, for example, to be in a secure environment amongst children. Could you expand a little bit about that and how perhaps legislation can be better used to deal with those scenarios?
It's a difficult one because it's much easier to have an arbitrary age that everybody can work towards. But I think there is room for legislation to allow for a discretionary appeal. So that if you were to go to a 17-year-old at the moment, or an 18-year-old, not quite 19, who has been assessed as having very high risk, who is likely to be spending the rest of his sentence in an adult establishment anyway, and who can no longer benefit from everything that the secure estate offers, mm-hmm. at that point, a multidisciplinary team could recommend that they have the discretion to move them into the prison estate. And I think that should be a possibility. Equally, a 22, 23-year-old in Pulmont, who very clearly has got massive immaturity issues, is there room to consider whether... You couldn't be 23 at the moment, but the 18-year-old, the 19-year-old, is able to move to the secure estate without having to go back to the court. Mm. So I think there is that possibility. I'm quite happy with the age being 18 at the moment. I think it's a massive first step, And, you know, while I know all the evidence indicates that brain maturation doesn't happen till 25, I know that work is going ahead for children who've experienced care to be supported later. The sentencing guidelines are looking at that. Actually, let's just get the first step done and stop 16, 17 and 18-year-olds going into prison. You know, I think you hear it from the prison service. It's not a therapeutic environment. Mm-hmm. It probably could be, but it's going to require considerable resources, whereas those resources already exist in secure estate.
You probably listened quite a lot to the work we did on bail and release and custody. I'm sure you followed that. And one of the comments made was that this really is, you know, political decisions are often down to what the public appetite is for risk. And do you think there is a public appetite for the direction of travel where 21, 22, 23-year-olds who have committed serious offences would be deemed as children in the eyes of the judicial system?
No, I don't think there is at the moment. I wouldn't be able to answer that. I would have to look at any evidence on public opinion that's gone ahead. But I think there is a public appetite for up to 18-year-olds, yes.
Okay, so. Thank you. Thanks, Kinvenor.
Thank you. Katie and then Fulton.
Yeah, I mean, just quite briefly, it's really just to pick up on quite a few of the points that were raised by Jamie, and really just to get a better understanding of why it is that now we have 16 and 17-year-olds in the prison estate, and I appreciate that you've said it's down to the court, really. I mean, to what extent do you have children on remand in secure units now?
Currently, we don't have any children in remand.
So that's,
I mean, that's not representative of the whole secure estate, but right now we do not have a child on remand.
So it tends to be convicted children referred
by the children's panel. There is an anomaly that the bill should resolve, where we have young people, 16 and 17-year-olds, who have had a short escalation within criminal justice, who have not benefited from the children's here, or services dedicated, you know, identified their trauma and vulnerabilities throughout their life. And I'm hopeful that the bill will resolve and allow those 16, 17-year-olds to access that. Now, there's the remittal provision that exists in terms of kind of remitting back to the children's hearing. That isn't always exercised. So what you might find is a young person who's maybe been at part, or they've been involved in a serious offence without necessarily a pattern of offending, the provision of the children's hearing isn't open to them, or is not readily available to them. And those young people are maybe the ones who are in for 7 days or 11 days, where people are trying to resolve that because they haven't got the legal framework or the pathway that's been the established pathway in place. So that's where you'll find some of the short journeys.
Right. And so in the past, I mean, are there ever children that are on remand that you have? It's just that you
absolutely,
don't happen to have any at the moment.
Yeah,
I understand that. And one of the other, you know, issues that's being raised by the bill is in relation to children being detained in police custody, so children being kept in cells. I mean, is that something that you've looked at? And do you think there are, you know, there are ever circumstances where that is just a necessity, or what would your view be in terms of those issues? I mean, potentially that, you know, it could be, you know, if somebody's arrested on a Friday, it could be that they're held, you know, potentially to a Monday. Does that happen? Is that something that you're aware of? Or is there a different provision in those kind of very short situations?
It shouldn't happen. It happens. Occasions are rare now. Mm. Again, children who are subject to compulsory supervision measures, they would... should not be held within in police custody any longer than possible. That responsibility generally sits with the local authority to provide an alternative, I'm using a legal term saying place of safety, but to provide a provision that would be satisfy the police and satisfy the risk.
And would you envisage going forward that you know, children that are in that position who have risks associated with them because of the nature of the offence are likely to be taken for short periods of time to secure units? Would that be your understanding of policy going forward? Is that what's being suggested as you understand it?
The barrier to that currently is largely financial, you know. Mm. So if that wasn't there, they didn't have the financial barrier, then mm-hmm. there wouldn't really be the question. You know, I think the police, you know, a desk sergeant doesn't want a 16-year-old in his custody and his care for the night when they don't have the provision in place to address their trauma, to address the risk and the impact it may have on the other people there. This is people are pushing an open door on this one, but it's the financial barriers in place because a local authority could then be held accountable at short notice for a child that's not really on their radar and having to make decisions around that with a financial.
And on that, I mean, because a lot of this debate is about resources, yeah. Also how we shift resources is part of the debate as well. We've been given figures, and we have figures in terms of the cost of prison, which we're often told is about £40,000 a year, but there's actually a huge variation between different prisons, and the newer prisons are a lot cheaper than the older prisons. Do we have any kind of data on the average cost of keeping a child in a secure unit? Just to get a feel for the resource issues.
It's around about four times as much.
Four times.
As much as it would cost in the prison. Mm-hmm. Okay. Because our children, they're out and about all the time. Mm-hmm. So we rely much more on relational security than perhaps the prison has the opportunity to do so.
That's helpful, Gerald.
I was just going to say, to confirm your question, we will have examples of children who go through the criminal justice system who will go into police custody, spend a night or multiple nights if it's a weekend mm-hmm. in police custody and then be committed to prison. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
OK, I don't know if anybody else wants to maybe come in or just before we move on that at all.
Well, I suppose it was really to come in on that and stress that, as Wendy says, this is we are all agreed that this is a good bill. When it comes to implementation, however, there's always the risk that there's simply not the capacity in the system to be able to respond to the newness. It takes time to train staff. To train social workers takes between 2 and 4 years, for example, to get the places of safety, make sure that local authorities have the financial resource and their physical resources around to be able to do that. So I suppose I would just stress that whilst this is good legislation in the completely the direction, no problem with that, the implementation of this could be quite risky in terms of having the right resource in the right places as we go forward.
Because one of the difficulties we do have is recruiting and retaining the right staff, the right care staff. So these are high risk environments. staff get assaulted, they're high risk. So we need to make this a sector that is really, where people feel really proud to be part of, they feel supported and kept safe, and the resilience is part of that. That is just the norm. That takes an incredible amount of investment too, and we often have my panacea, but it requires investment, it requires money. I believe it's a spend to save approach, but I think there is a reality that whilst we require this resource, there is a real risk, as Alan says, that we will pull resource away from other sectors. So we need to ensure that doesn't happen, because we would recruit from the same pool of people.
Okay, thank you very much. Anne Fulton.
Convener, and the end of that conversation, it's been a theme throughout, I know, but it probably leads on quite nicely to my line of question, which is about resourcing, and I'll split it into two. But I just wanted to say, firstly, which might be helpful, in a previous life as a social worker, when I was in children and families in secure accommodation visiting my young people there, and I have to say, it's almost always been a very positive experience. St Mary's is one I visited several times, several years ago now. So I just thought that would be good to put on the record. And it is, and for colleagues' benefit, it is very much a secure environment where the risk of absconding, as you highlighted earlier, Jim, is extremely low, but also a very therapeutic environment. And as I said, can lead to really good results. So on that basis, more people accessing that seems to be sensible. In terms of the resourcing aspect, I wanted to ask, firstly, probably for yourself, Lorraine and Jim, do you think that what more resources can be put in if the aims of this bill are to be met? Is it about bolstering what's already there with the four or five provisions? Or is it about creating more? Would you like to see the state, either through Scottish Government or local authorities,
produce, to replicate what you've got, or do you think it's about bolstering what's already in place?
I think what would be really good is to sit around the table and do an options appraisal, because I think there are pros and cons with every type of model. At the moment, the way the contracts are arranged for secure care, we compete against each other. Mm-hmm. Now, there's lots of positives around that, but it also inhibits collaboration as well. So I think it would be really useful to sit down and explore and map out what those options would look like. Because on the one hand, you know, a national service would be potentially the answer, and it's, you know, it's centrally funded, and you know, there's equity of distribution. But it might be that, you know, you have lots of expertise around these secure centres have been going for a, you know, long, long time. That, you know, there's pockets of expertise that maybe wouldn't want to fall into that too. So I don't think that's a very easy question to answer. But, and I do think there are different ways to do it. I don't think the opportunity to explore that has actually taken place the way that it should have at the moment.
And how does it, just, I know you're going to come in, Jim, but how does the sector already engage with the, and it's the one that, in my personal life, I haven't visited, is the one you've referred to in Edinburgh, which is local authority run. How does the sector interact with that just now?
So the Scottish Government do facilitate regular conversations between the five centres, and we have interactions. I think I could probably add a little bit to what Lorraine said. My initial response is bolster what we have. You know, bolster what we have. You've got a lot of experience in there. You've people that went on the journey over the past 25 years, effectively, you know, since the secure estate's been developed in Scotland, with the view to you know, creating what will very much like an options appraisal or discussion about a shared way forward. What I do know is the value base and intention across, commonly referred to as the secure estate, is pretty similar. You know, the morals, what we believe in, what we're looking to achieve for children, the risk management strategies, you know, there's a pretty clear consensus. There's not many people pushing against that, but the competitive nature of the current financial structure prevents us making the best of it and maximising. And that's probably something that I think the bill could support us with, and certainly the government could support us with. Because ultimately, you know, we're talking about secure centres. What we really should be talking about is the children. You know, we're talking about the children not going into YOI. We're talking about the children not returning into secure care. And not necessarily standardised approach, because we want innovation. We want people to learn more and develop, and for this to be a research and growing provision. But we also want us to all have a shared, you know, a shared purpose. And that needs to be child-centred. We need to look at the children and focus on how we're going to stop children in that revolving door and prolonged period within the prison, you know, secure them prison.
And so on that basis, would you like to see a change in terms of how or who makes that decision? Because I can certainly remember that, you know, you got your chief executive for your local authority, and they make the chief executive for the social worker, the department is for any local authority, to make that decision. And you need to go back. I think you referred to it wouldn't be 9 months like some of the cross-border ones are. It would be every 4 or 6 weeks, mm-hmm. perhaps. Would you like to see who makes that decision change? Because you could obviously get a lot of variance between local authorities. Would it be somebody more central, or are you quite or is it more about training of local authorities?
The chief social worker decision is tested. Do you know, it's a 72-hour authorisation, and then you have a children's hearing that's going to have a bearing on that and make that decision. Albeit the chief social worker has the option to not take that direction. Where I'm not going to answer your question direct, but what I would like to see in line with the bill is greater professionalisation of the children's hearing process. So, you know, get some real informed decision making and supporting. You know, I wouldn't want to disrupt the Kilbrandon approach, because it sets us apart in Scotland. You know, it's something we're very proud of, and we've maintained a child in need approach longer than most. You know, we're kind of ahead of the curve on that one. However, given that we're looking to remove children from YOIs, and we're working with the critical few, that we need a professional eye on it. You know, we need the children's reporter just can't be somebody who's there to administer legal competence. We'd be looking for, you know, the insight of a sheriff. You know, Jamie did make a point where we were discussing about sheriffs having a level of autonomy around sentencing options. They've also got a wealth of experience. You know, they've seen the young people who have progressed the revolving doors, and I think the bill presents an opportunity for increased professionalism around the children's hearing system and the decision-making process for detaining children.
Thanks. And just one further question, if that's all right, and it's for yourself, Alison. It's the other side of that resources, because I know you mentioned it right back at the start. What do you think the bill can do in terms of making use of other resources to prevent people needing, I know it's a million-dollar question, but prevent people needing secure in the first place the resources at a community level? I know you've touched on it throughout some of the answers, but I'll give you a chance to sort of expand on that.
I guess it's a range of things, and there's a lot of things in the children's policy arena. We've got the promise, we've got GOFEC, we've got the children's hearings, I've got a whole list of them somewhere. And for me, there's something that all of these things need to progress in alignment and be sequenced very, very carefully in order to make sure that where we are, where we can move resource. I may be a little bit sceptical that there is resource to move, okay? Because I think if it was that easy, we would have done it, right? There is an issue about resource, and I think we need a grown-up conversation about that if we want to do this. I mean, you've heard how much more it costs to keep somebody to have a child insecure than in prison, and quite rightly too. But that's the kind of the resourcing isn't simply going to shift. So we need to take all of these things, the children's hearing system, the reimagining secure care. We need to work out where there will be savings in the future, because there will be. That is, if we prevent and do early support, there will be. But that doesn't happen straight away. There is a time where that things need to be probably double funded, right, as that movement and that shift, and as our staff and the environments that we work in move to a more early support, preventive, family supportive model. And this is part of that, this bill is definitely part of that whole direction of travel in Scotland. So I suppose what I would plea for is, again, it's around good implementation, which is understanding about what is in the environment, the rest of the environment, which is not just this bill. It's about how it interacts with all these other things in the children and families policy arena, and with anything that's going on in youth justice and support for younger adults. We just think very carefully and are prepared in the short term to do some double resourcing on the basis that we really believe that putting early support in will reduce costs in the future. You know, we know that. Okay. I'm afraid I didn't really answer your question, it's wider than this bill.
Yeah, agreed.
Thank you very much. That's just coming up to 12:30. I admire your staying power and your patience, but I think I speak on behalf of members when I say it's been a really helpful and informative session for us. So thank you all very much for attending this morning, and we'll just have a short suspension before we move into private session. Thank you.